great pleasure, a great honour, of course, to have the Deputy Director General of Climate and Natural Resources at the FAO. Ladies and gentlemen, Maria Helena Semedo. Maria. Welcome. Please.
Good afternoon to all. I know it has been a long and a busy day. You discussed several themes. Unfortunately, I couldn't be here. I will try to summarize what I imagine has been the discussion you had today. I know we'll have a sum up afterwards. I listened to the last panel, but let me share with you some of my thoughts coming from my organization. You have a flavor what we do, but also from my personal experience. Dear friends, ladies and gentlemen, dear participants, you have heard it all day. One of the greatest challenges of our time is how to increase food production and nourish a growing population, while sustainably managing our planet's natural resources in a changing climate. 3 years ago, in this very city, promises were made to end hunger, malnutrition, and extreme poverty, to deliver inclusive growth, to transition to a sustainable development, to transform. Today, we are still far from overcoming this challenge, far from meeting our goals, far from keeping our promises. New evidence reported this month by FAO in the state of food security and nutrition in the world confirm, unfortunately, that hunger is rising from 804 million in 2016 to 821 million in 2017. And as I said before, we committed to end hunger by 2030. In an age of plenty, that is 1 in 9 people going to bed on an empty stomach. Figures from nutrition are not better. 1 in 3 people suffer from malnutrition. Almost of a quarter of children under 5 are stunted, and adult obesity now accounts for more than 1 in 8 adults in the world. And what we can say now, that in the past, we had obesity in some parts of the world, more in the north. Now, I can tell you where obesity has increased more in the last years is in Africa, where we have the highest rate of malnutrition is where obesity is growing and they are coexisting together. At the same time, world losses or waste, about a third of the food it produces every year. Food losses and waste affect both consumers and producers. This raises the price of food and decreases the amount that can be sold. It stresses our ecosystem and endangers our environment through greenhouse gas production emission. Let's face it, and you just referred to it. Our current food systems are broken. To achieve the 2030 agenda, they must be fixed. The very way food is grown, stored, transported, traded, marketed, and consumed has to be more fair, more efficient, and sustainable. Ladies and gentlemen, a few months ago, FAO launched a report for decision makers entitled 20 Interconnected Actions to Transform Food and Agriculture. And I wish to highlight 3 key main messages that I strongly believe can help to fix our food system. And my first message is, producing more food does not necessarily mean less hunger, improved nutrition, and good health. Today, there is easily enough food produced for everyone on the planet, but hundreds of millions are going without. And malnutrition
through rising health bills for non-communicable diseases like heart disease and diabetes cost the global economy $3.5 trillion per year. Malnutrition is especially rising fast in Africa, where rapid urbanization means poor people have easy access to cheap, energy-dense, processed food high in fats, sugar, and salts. We are finding both, as I refer, undernutrition and obesity in the same poor families, the double burden of malnutrition. We are witnessing a globalization of obesity that will devastate society and economies unless we take action now. Obesity is not about rich countries, but poor ones too. And obesity is not a private issue, it's a public problem. A problem of both access and availability. How can we defeat hunger and malnutrition? We must first tackle food insecurity and inequality through social protection and pro-poor growth programs. Ensure all people have access to affordable and nutritious food, that our food systems are built to maximize nutrition, not profit at all costs. We must invest in nutrition-sensitive agriculture that balance nourishing people while nurturing the planet. Let me highlight one fact that best expresses the critical connection between agriculture, nutrition, and biodiversity. The increasing concentration of the global food insecurity has contributed to a situation where just four of the 30,000 edible plants provide 60% of the world's dietary energy intake. Just relying on such narrow numbers, particularly in a changing climate, increases the vulnerability of agriculture system and put food security and nutrition at risk. And you see that we have putting pressure in only five of our so rich biodiversity. Variety is the spice of life. We need to ensure that food systems prioritize the availability of healthy food for local markets at accessible cost. This was a key message of the last week food FAO State of Agriculture Community Markets, which reported that most of the world's smallholder farmers, mainly in Africa, would be severely impacted by climate change. And the second message is, urbanization is a golden opportunity for agriculture and rural renewal. And when I arrived, we are discussing about the linkage on urban-rural linkage and how are the impacts on the food system. Urban food demands already consumes some 70% of national food supplies. And by 2050, two-thirds of us will be living in cities. If managed well, rising urban demand for food can be used to transform food system and generate new economic opportunities in off-farm agriculture-related activities. As outlined in the new urban agenda, integrated rural-urban territorial development approach can stimulate entrepreneurship, empower women, create jobs for rural youth, and provide fresh and nutritious cities food to cities. And it was also referred to the Pact of Milan, linking cities to food producers. This creates space for small producers to coexist side by side with larger retailers. Rural-urban linkages are growing all over the world. One example is in Medellin, Colombia, where FAO is helping the government implementing sustainable food action, focusing primarily on governance, climate risk, and market infrastructure. In the cities of Nairobi, Dhaka, and Lima in Peru, FAO supports government in multi-sector food planning, already attracting international donors and collaborators. And my third message is that sustainable agriculture can be the answer for reversing trends that lead to the deterioration of natural resources. High input, resources-intensive farming systems simply cannot deliver sustainable food and agriculture. Today, globally, one-third of land is degraded. 22% of animal breeds are at risk. About a third of the fish stock are overfished. In the first decade of this century, some 13 million hectares of forest were converted into other land use each year. We must look at food, people's well-being, livelihoods, and the management of natural resources as one. It was also referred to interlinkage. We cannot continue to have silos approach. We need to have an interconnected, a systematic approach. The only way to meet significant increase in water, energy, and food needs of the future is to shift to more sustainable consumption and production. Diversifying production practices, for example, through agroecology, agroforestry, crop aquaculture, crop livestock, or organic farming, can grow more and healthy food with fewer resources. Mainstreaming biodiversity and integrating landscape approaches into action, policies and investment, and supporting farmers rights to genetic resources can lead to building resilient livelihoods and ensuring our planet rich variety of life. Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, where do we focus action? I told you what are the problems. Now let's see what are the solutions. How do we implement a sustainable food approach? First, our prime focus must be the 2.5 billion family farmers who produce 3/4 of the world's food and manage a large part of the planet's natural resources and food biodiversity. Directing our investment to these rural agents of change, small-scale farmers, fisher folks, foresters, women and youth, and indigenous people, pastoralists, can help realize their great potential and drive inclusive growth. Let me talk about women. I cannot be here and not talk on women. Those who toil our soil. In Africa, women make up 60% of the labor force in family farming. They need access to the resource that will allow our food system to thrive. Closing productivity gaps could increase food production and consumption by up to 10% and reduce poverty by up to 13%. Secondly, by creating an enabling, incentivizing environment, can move all actors forward together for the health and wealth of the nation. This whole of government approach should focus on building smallholders alliance and supportive public policies and investment, and ensure market participation by small-scale farmers. We need to give more space to small-scale producers to sell affordable local foods and access bigger markets. The right investment will ensure farmers grow healthy, diverse, produce for local markets, that citizens can afford to buy nutritious food. Cannot be only for the healthy people. And that consumers can make healthier dietary choice. Third, by unlocking the potential of the private sector for innovation. Private sector partnership, promise technology development, knowledge transfer and innovation, job creation and alternative revenue streams. Food has shaped the past, but how will it shape our future? Private sector innovation is key to new crop varieties, new pest control and post-harvest policies and practices, and engaging with markets in new ways. Take the example of mobile technology, where traders were previously unlikely to travel to remote areas unless guaranteed a sale. Today, sellers not only rely information on quantity, location, and price, but also use device to bargain. We also, in FAO, use this device to see when you have a pest, they can take a picture and send to us to see which kind of pest it is and how should be the solutions we provide to them. They are closer to us and to each other. A FAO project with the Rabobank Foundation is providing thousands of smallholder families in Tanzania, Kenya, and Ethiopia access to financial instruments and mobile technology to gain this valuable market information. Ladies and gentlemen, the way our food and agriculture systems evolve will affect everything we want to change. Transforming our food systems will transform our world. And I thank you for your attention.